Our next speaker is Alexander Sir. He's going to talk about something very interesting, both Einstein condensate, fast particles, and also second sum in room temperature magnet condensate. That's what.
Thank you very much for the kind presentation, and thank you organizers for invitation me to do this talk in such interesting place and interesting audience. And I should say is that in my abstract, title was a little different. The title was named as Bose-Einstein condensation of quasi-particles by rapid cooling. But I have recognized that it's too narrow item, and that is why I want to place it more broad context. And here it's Bose-Einstein condensation of quasi-particles and second sound in the room temperature magnet condensate. So this work, it's experimental work, was performed in the group of Professor Hillebrands. It's Arbeit's group, it's work group, Magnetismus University of Kaiserslautern and in German, small city nearby of Frankfurt. So, and here I have marked a few people who contribution is especially important and for the success of this work and obtaining of that results, which I will present just now. And the first I want to mark here Dr. Dmytro Bushkova, previous PhD student, and now he is a postdoc in Glasgow in a group of Martin Wydes and works on the quantum computing, but he already accepted the position of assistant professor at University of Colorado in Fort Collins. And also it's our previous postdoc, Dr. Ulrich Mack, which just yesterday accepted the position of professor in University of Vienna. And also, it's I should not forget about the Dr. Vitaly Vasyuchka, who works intensively in area of magnet gases and condensate, and also our PhD students, Michael Schneider and Alexander Kreil. Results which were obtained by these two PhD students are mostly present today. And our success would not be possible without strong theoretical support from and encouraging us from the these our external collaborations, and especially I want to mark Professor Gennady Milko from my alma mater from the Russian International University of Kyiv, it's from Ukraine, and also we have a strong collaboration with Dr. Vasily Tiberkevich and Professor Andrei Slavin from Auckland University from Rochester University, and also is presenting here Victor Lvov and Anna Pomelov. It's from Weizmann Institute of Science, Rehovot from Israel. And here on the right side, here you see that we can identify as a name as a magnon gas, the set of processing magnetic moments. It's electron magnetic moments, which macro spins principally here, which is the external magnetic field process, but decoupled each other by exchange interaction and by long range dipole interaction by magnetic fields, which are generated here. This precession is not independent, and you see that some art of wave propagated equilibrium is presented on the right side. It's so called spin waves, intensively investigated in the area of magnetism. And normally they are formed in ferromagnetics and in such iron, cobalt, magnetic oxides, and other such iron ferromagnetics. And in the frame of the second quantization, we can introduce magnets as a quantum resistant phase, exactly as photons as a quantum electromagnetic phase, for example, phonon of acoustic waves. And as here, the motion of these spin waves, mostly dispersion of spin waves, is mostly determined in the large area of phase space by exchange interaction. In such a case, it's, we have the quadratic dispersion rule and can introduce energy, can introduce momentum, can introduce easily mass from this quadratic dispersion rule, and also spin. And spin is introduced automatically because this spin wave, what does it mean, one magnet? Well, spin of one electron is oriented up, and after that turns down, and spin is 1/2. It's the total change in spin, which is associated with formation of this quasi-particle, is 1. It means that we have a bosonic particle. So, and these bosonic particles here, they are weakly interacting, weakly or strongly interacting, depends on the density, and we can introduce this as a gas, weakly interacting particles, which can scatter in the process of 2 and 3 magnet scattering process. And for process it's such, it's 2 input particles and 2 output particles with different energy and after collision and momentum. 3 magnet scattering, you see that here in such process when 2 magnets confluence or 2 magnets, 1 magnet splits, for example, in such a case, should be satisfied momentum energy conservation loss in any case, diseases, for any interaction process, but spin is not conserved. Spin is translated to the entire sample, and this is what we should not take care about conservation of spin. If you have dipolar interactions, there is interaction with the electron spins and photon. Such. And magnets, as I have told just now, are bosons, and similar to other quasi particles of such kind, they're described in thermal equilibrium by Bose-Einstein distribution with zero chemical potential. So, with zero temperature, we have no magnets. Nothing is excited, system is in ground state. But with term temperature and with zero chemical potential, it's described by such distribution. As it is demonstrated here, it's calculated real distribution of magnets. But if you externally inject magnets beyond the thermal equilibrium level, the calculations say that it is enough to inject 2-3% above the thermal, the density of thermal magnets in given temperature. This increases the chemical potential to the bottom of magnet spectrum, there is a gap in this spectrum, and leads to Bose-Einstein condensation scenario even at room temperature. And you see the distribution from this Bose-Einstein distribution, which is demonstrated here, is changed to this green line with a chemical potential equal to the energy of the, to the minimal energy in spin waste. And such transition was demonstrated by us in collaboration with a group of Professor Dimitrov, Professor Mungo, and Professor Slavin, still in 2006. It is very similar, it's not such unique process. Such process exists in exciton polaritons after that it was demonstrated in Hamburg, for example, for photons. Such, and why it is possible at room temperature, which is time to time in such conferences, where concentrated on classical superfluidic, classical. I want to say that such superfluidity or superconductivity, it's only due to that we have really weakly interacting particles and we can increase the density very small. So density of thermal magnets is 10 order 22 per cubic centimeter at room temperature. And we can pump 10 order 20 in shape externally. 20, so which is 3, 2, 3, 5% excess in magnet density is easily possible. And there is no condensation of such. It is also the difference with diluted atomic gases, as they weakly interacting, they don't constitute some transition to the liquid phase or to something such. It's still is the gas. And in which medium we observe. And in here, we have seen the presentation of neutron stars, we have seen the presentation of helium 4, we have seen helium 3, for example. By the way, helium 3, as Vladimir Yeltsin demonstrated yesterday, it's also possible such type of condensation with nuclear spins, not with electron spins. But in our case, if you are working at room temperature, the medium is so called yttrium ion guard. It's magnetic oxide, it's very good isolator. The structure is very complicated. In the elementary, it's cubic crystal, that is why it's rather symmetrical, but unit cell consists from 80 atoms. And in different iron atoms, which are placed here in different crystallographic positions, octahedral and tetrahedral positions, with the spin 5 over 2, they will demonstrate such non-compensated magnetic moment. They are coupled in the antiferromagnetic ordering in opposite directions and demonstrate the magnetic moment on a new cell approximately 20 magnetons or at 0 temperature. Such magnetization, and from this, we can calculate how many magnets at the thermal equilibrium, what is the maximum at any temperature, what is the maximum quantity of magnets in hours. And this, this material is perfectly described in the preview article of Chiripano, Kolokolov, and Viktor Rogovich's Here the Saga of Itrumanga at Spectra Thermodynamics Interactions, Relaxation of Magnets in a Complex Magnet. But investigation of this still not stop. For example, you can see in the these in quantum materials articles the full magnet spectrum of yttrium ion garnet published in 2017. Such when it's calculated the spectrum from the first principle. And why it is so interesting for us? It's due to that fact that coupling between electron spins and orbital moments is very weak in this material. So, and that is why the processing energy of spins, the energy from spin system, is practically conserved there and only very slowly translated to the thermal phonon best, to the lattice. And it is, I should say, that the lowest magnet damping of any known material in the world has this medium. And it can be produced in different forms, in forms of monocrystals, for example, it can be produced in form of silicates. For example, here you see the film produced in Ukraine, and here the thickness is approximately, from the color I can see, approximately 6.5 microns. But in our area, investigated films with the thicknesses starting now from 10 nanometers, produced in different. It's liquid phase epitaxy, it can be produced in different. So, because it's, it can be applied not only for the investigation of magnet gases condensate, but also in practical magnetronics, spintronics. And as it can be used at room temperature, such magnet condensate, which I want to demonstrate practically, basically have a potential for practical applications. For example, it's spontaneous appearance of coherency in chaotic system, which can be used for transfer of information or for processing. Such. And what I should say, the lowest magnet damping, but how low? What does it mean? So exponential relaxation time, it's approximately, in standard fields, it's approximately 250 nanoseconds. So is it, the excitations can survive long as microseconds. It can be reached in the good, very good samples up to 700. When you reduce the temperature, it's not so simple, but it's necessary to. So is in some samples damping increases, in some samples damping decreases. It depends on contamination of elements. So there is potential for investigations at low temperatures. Let's go to the spectrum of magnets in such a system. Here you see that there is yttrium ion garnet field, which is magnetized in place. I should say that it's very important how these fields are magnetized. Out of plane, in plane, because you see if you're in plane, waves can propagate along the magnetization direction and across the magnetization direction. And exchange interaction doesn't depend on this fact, but dipolar interaction, magnetic field related interaction, strongly depends on this, and this is how determine the entire spectrum. So if the waves propagate, how will you discover? We will describe using the Landau-Lipschitz equation. The name Landau was mentioned here many times. He is also known for this equation. And here is the torque equation, change of magnetic moment with time, and here's the torque, and here's the effective field, ferromagnetic ratio, and effective field includes itself external bias magnetic field to magnetize the system. It's DC magnetic field, effective magnetic field, a field which arises due to the dipolar interaction between magnetic moments. Here's a green function, and also the exchange interaction related effective fields. Here's the exchange thickness constant, magnetization, gradient of magnetization. And plus, you can include the additional components in these effective fields, which describe magnetoelastic interaction. Describe also here, you can you see the conservative equation, but you can include here the additional damping terms. It's a phenomenology, damping terms, which is included as viscosity, like gives us viscosity like. But let's look now on this spectrum of eigen excitation. You see here, I can, there are many modes here, and these modes it gives us non-uniform distribution based on the thickness of the field in this direction. It's so-called sickness models. The energy increases with increase of variation by sickness due to the exchange interaction, and you see that these modes goes up and up. And here the bunch of modes which propagates in perpendicular direction to the bias magnetic field, that means in the direction in field plane. And here is blue, I can indicate the modes which propagates along the magnetic. And you see here, it's mostly no influence of dipolar interaction. There is parabolic increase in energy. It's mostly due to the exchange interaction. What occurs with the waves which propagates along bias magnetic field? First, due to the demagnetization contribution of nearby staying magnetic moments, energy falls down with increase of wave vector. And after that, it should be saturated here to some frequency. But due to the increase in energy with increase of K number due to the exchange interaction, we see the parabolic increase. And this competition between the dipolar and exchange interaction between magnetic moments, we have a minimum in this here. And this minimum can be used to obtain potential condensation. How we will inject magnets? How can we inject magnets? We can inject magnets by external electromagnetic. For example, paramagnetic resonance very well. There is another more effective method as parametric excitation. When one photon of electromagnetic field splits in two magnets with opposite wave numbers, because the wave vector of electromagnetic wave in comparison with the size of the sample and these wavelengths of K of spin waves is near zero, it means that due to the momentum conservation law, energy conservation law, this photon should split in two magnets with half frequency and with opposite wave vectors. Something like this. And after that, these magnets, if the density increases, they scatter on each other, and due to the four magnets scattering, populate the entire lower part of the spectrum and establish quasi equilibrium. It's called. It would be good if they would not decay. It's a pity, but they decay. Such. But this establishment of equilibrium can occur at the time scales which 10 or 100 times faster than decay time. That is why we can speak about the quasi equilibrium. And after that, chemical potential increases, reaches the bottom, and then reaches the bottom, potentially condensation establishment is expected. How it appears, it should appear here. The increase in density of magnets beyond the thermal distribution in these points, in two points, by the way, it's with opposite K numbers. And what we have here from the chaotic spin waves here is chaotic phases, we should obtain here two coherent waves. So, how can we investigate this? We can investigate this principally, it would be possible if it's a spin wave with dipolar contribution, it would be possible to inductively detect. For example, this has been done in helium 3 by Mikhail Sergeyevich Bunko in group of Borodin Kramarov, actually has detected the formation of Eisenstein condensate in helium 3. And there is why it was possible, because the Eisenstein condensate was formed with K number around zero. As for magnetic transsexual domain. And in our case, wave number is rather large. It's approximately wave number in this point for our samples is about 2 microns. It's possible technically to detect, we try, but not so easy, let's say such. And that is why we use very well established in our group method of optical detection. It's brilliant light scattering spectroscopy. When we will illuminate our sample with laser, coherent laser light, this light scatters from magnets inside, such and with scatters with conservation of energy and momentum. Some magnets are annihilated, some are created in such codes, and that is why around the elastically scattered light component in frequency spectrum appears Stokes anti-Stokes component, which has shifted in frequency. On a frequency of spin wave or frequency magnets which participate in the process, and intensities of these components are proportional to the density of magnets. in that way, which we will prove. It's a truth. Is it enough? Let's look. Frequency resolution. Because the spectrum of the scattered light after the illumination, we can analyze this interferometer. Interferometer should work in the frequency range, in the rather large frequency range, and that is why resolution is not very high, approximately 50 megahertz. And you can compare this with line width of potentially condensate of ferromagnetic resonance here, approximately 2 megahertz. That is why with such system we are not able to detect coherency in the field. Moreover, if you will look here, we can scan the entire spectrum, we can look on the distribution of magnets over this spectrum. But if you will analyze what occurs at the bottom, we will have some wave vector uncertainty in the frame of frequency resolution. You see, I can't distinguish this state, and this. That is why I don't know where in reality the accumulation. And here you can see that the range is 10,000 inverse centimeters. It's not good. That is why we have implemented in the system wave number resolution. Wave number resolution is can be implemented rather easily, principally, but not so easily technically, when we have our sample with Riemann Barnett film in the cross section, and the spin wave propagates in the plane, and here we will illuminate it with the external light. The first, due to the Bragg reflection, this light is reflected from the wavefront of magnet, and after that, is reflected from underlying metallic and dielectric mirror, and propagates in the opposite direction to the interferometer. It's clear that the first, this reflection is possible only for the specific wavelengths of, of spin waves. Wavelengths of light is determined by our system. And here there is a very simple relation between the K number, wave number of laser light, and wave number of spin waves participate in the process, and theta is incident angle in our system. When I change the incident angle, I can pick up the signals from magnets with different wave numbers. And here, how it was realized in practice, we have such input light passed through the pinhole, after that lens, a few prisms focused on our sample, which is magnetized by this external electric magnet. And we, by rotating through this system, we can change probe direction, incident light direction, and such. We can, from the angle, incident angle, we can determine which magnets we analyze it. And the resolution is rather good, considering that this is Bose-Einstein condensate, resolution is approximately 2 plus. Okay, here, the system, not so simple, it should excite magnet condensate, it should detect if everything should be synchronized, and we will excite with the external microwave generator, amplify, send to microstrip antenna, which excites, which creates a microwave Oersted field around it, and which creates a pumping, gives us the pumping source there. And after that, we excite magnets in our system, and laser is also chirp in the pulses to control the heat deposition in our sample, not overheating locally with our probing light. And after that, is reflected back. Goes to the tandem Fabry-Perot interferometer, to photon detector, and to the data acquisition. And we have here time, space, and wave vector resolution. Space, because we applied impulses and can look in which moment of time we have response of our system. Wave vector from the direction of probing. Space, it will scan our sample with respect to the probing, light. Here and here is the bottom of spectrum. And let's look what occurs here at the bottom of spectrum. In this area, which is accessible for us. And if you apply the small pump power, rather small, it's 1 watt, but in pulse, it's big. So we don't overheat the sample. So, and here you see wave numbers in the vertical, which corresponds to the dispersion curve. And here, time pulse is applied in this moment of time, inject magnets, but it's necessary time for magnets to be thermalized, scatters. And only after some time, they will go to the bottom of spectrum. And what the signal is from the bottom of spectrum here and forms appears here from the high wave numbers and after that populates the area around the global minimum energy here. And after some time, Bose-Einstein condensate appears exactly at this global minimum position. Back is home during the pumping pulse is on. When I switch pumping pulse off, BC decays exponentially. Okay, I would like to have here more pronounced BC, more pronounced such. And for this, I would like, naively thinking, to increase the density of injected matter. To pump not 1% more, but 3% more. This way. And here, pumping power was increased to 25 watts. If I really pump more, yes, you see, migrants appears at the bottom is much more smaller delay. Here, you see interval, top interval, and here practically no delay. It means the density of migrants is very high, much more higher than previous, and the efficiency of scattering is much more effective. But there is no concentration of magnets around the local minimum. Magnets are concentrated in this area. No condensed state. Why? We should take into account in Bose-Einstein distribution not only chemical potential but also temperature. It's not the temperature of four numbers, it's temperature only of magnetic system. We injected a lot of magnets to the bottom of spectrum. It is in order to describe this with Bose-Einstein distribution. With chemical potential zero or non-zero, we should increase temperature. And this temperature, if you calculate, using, for example, relations, is, even the relations can be used to calculate it, classical, such quasi-classical situation, effective temperature 30,000. It's effective temperature. It's only reflection of very high density of magnets. But if you will switch pumping pulse off, unexpectedly, magnets, which were after distributed here, moves to the global minimum and forms the pronounced maximum. Why? It is similar to this cup of hot coffee, and overpopulated low energy magnet states are inside, but they vapor. They will in phase space, not in real space. It's the same as cooling in trap of ultra cold atoms, but here magnets redistribute to the upper energy states, and average temperature goes down when we switch off the pumping, and potentially condensate is formed. We have this evaporative supercooling of strongly overheated low energy areas and magnets. Okay, it means,
where do they go, the high energy magnets?
Where they go, they redistribute to the higher energy states in the process of scattering, these four magnets scattering, and there they can interact with phonon best fast. They use the process, and that is why they redistribute goes up. And you see that we can conclude from this that condensate should be investigated in this area. It's free evolving condensate, not disturbed by the external pump. And if you will look here, pumping is switched off, and here there is a peak increase in the bottom density of magnets. In this, in the global minimum, and after that, you see, take care about the logarithmic scale, they attenuate exponentially, attenuate to the forward path. It is unavoidable process. It's the atoms move out from the laser trap. Such. And freely evolving magnets. What occurs if I evolved? I can manipulate with my laser line to pick up more strong or more weak signal. If I will increase later light intensity, I will accumulate my data much more fast. That is why I would like to do this. And if I will increase the later light intensity, you see that my previously exponential decay turns to be non-exponential here initially. You see, this I only increase the laser pulse power, and I see non-exponential decay faster. I check, maybe it is some destroying or potentially condensate by photon field. That is why we have hold intensity of the light, probing light, be constant, and increase only the duration of the probing laser pulse. So we have switched probing laser pulse earlier to hit this probing point. And it was shorter, and this we have changed T laser. And you see that T laser when increased, so probing spotted infrared camera photon, you see in such a case, we see that fast decay. But not always. When density cools down approximately 10 times to this critical level, after that, it doesn't depend what was the temperature in the point. The lower temperature, higher temperature, attenuation is the same. So it looks such when density of magnons is high and magnon BEC exists, attenuation in the hot spot is strong. But when it's turned out to the magnon gas due to the evaporation, for example, BEC, attenuation is elevated. I should say that increase in temperature is very small. It's approximately 5 Kelvin on the background of 300 seconds. So, how can we explain this? Due to the supercurrent in magnon BEC. So that if you look magnon BEC and describe this with the complex BEC wave function, here the supercurrent is very well known. Equation depends on the phase gradient of the condensate wave function. How we can create this phase gradient? This frequency at the bottom slightly depends on magnetization. And magnetization depends on temperature. With increase of temperature, we decrease the magnetization approximately 4 Gauss per Kelvin, and so creates magnetization gradient. And magnetization gradient changes the frequency and leads in course of time to accumulation of it. And we can assume that due to this fact, when we will hit, we create the, we implement the gradient in the phase gradient in the condensate wave function, and excite supercurrent of this, which propagates outside of the hot spot. By changing probing laser pulse duration, it's possible to control the phase of magnon BEC. And we have, with Professor Go developed the frequency, when we have taken into account this shift, it's what only one parameter what we have adjusted. This black line for undisturbed BEC for homogeneous temperature conditions, and after that we only change magnetization as a function of temperature, and we're able to perfectly describe these observed experimental diagrams, and moreover even determine the supercurrent velocity approximately 300 meters. So observed dynamic of magnon condensate can be understood take into account magnon supercurrents. But you see, it is only decay dynamics. So we really such understood, we were able to convince our reviewers that it's really magnon supercurrents, but it would be good to have additional evidence. For example, direct observation. Some evidences were obtained from the experiments of our colleagues from Münster University, Professor Demokritov, who worked with us for observation of Eisenstein magnon condensate. And he has partially non-uniform ground state and quantized vortices in a two-component Eisenstein condensate of magnets. They have observed experimentally such picture. We see here the standing wave, which is formed by two Eisenstein condensates with opposite k vectors. So it's evidence that really we have there some density of coherent wave. It's not only noise. And after that, they have, so with Natalia Berlov, they installed this coupled for two Eisenstein condensate generalized in the Landau equation you see here. Is, so it's a kind of Gross-Peterski equation, and they were able to mimic the structure which they have observed in the experiment. And here you see, they suppose that it is vortices of magnon supercurrent.
What is being plotted there?
Hmm?
What's being plotted?
What
is plotted? What quantity? Ooh. What are the colors?
Ah, color is high intensity, and blue is small intensity.
The density of magnons.
Density of magnons. It's, I should say that it's not zero density here. Difference between red and blue, it's a peaky, but it's such, it's only a few percent. That is why it's not very dense, essentially condensate, always a background of thermal magnets, such. And here the size of such vortex core, it's approximately approximately 1 micron. Let's remember this. So it means that this peak is right. So in the system, we can observe approximately in the size of our pumped area, 1 millimeter, we observe approximately 1,000 cores. So it's better than in ultra-cold atoms than cosmic fields for investigation. It's a question here. It's in-plane magnetized field. Supercurrent is the same in all directions, is isotropic or not? And the answer is not. It's probably anisotropic. And
can
if
ask,
you will look.
Can you ask before you go yeah. on to clarify? Why do you need the two?
It's not why we need. No, two components exist here with such a lone magnetic field and opposite magnetic field, the spectrum of spin waves. We can distinguish between these and these. They can form staggering wave, but we don't know if it's possible to form the Einstein condensate only with one component or two components and nesting phase in this.
But this ground state looks like a super solid. Very weak, right?
Okay, maybe. Such. And here, what we will see here, you see here spectrum at the bottom. It's I have. Take this, you see, from one dimensional spectrum, here the calculated two dimensional spectrum, here in x, y directions, magnetized in this direction by magnetic field, and you can see how it looks like. And here the two dimensional supercurrent in x and y direction, density of magnets, dispersion coefficients, which are inversely proportional to the mass of magnets here, and the corresponding gradients in this direction. Of phase function. And here the dx, dy component dispersion coefficients can be easily calculated. And because you can calculate the spectrum variance. And you see that one of these dispersion coefficients 20 times higher than another. That is why it's a motion of magnets in one direction when magnet moves there. It's a particle 20 times
faster. Not faster, heavier.
Heavier than in another direction. Heavier than in another direction. That is why here we can forget about the supercurrent in one direction and analyze in the first approximation one-dimensional supercurrent across bias magnetic field, across k vector of the carrier of the carrying wave here. Such one. It's the first. By the way, it is an interesting problem how it influences vortices shape and vortices formation, such problems. Okay. After that, when we have here, I thought it would be good for us to analyze, to observe supercurrent type as a motion of matter. We suppose it's such, if the heating spot, when we will heat it with laser, we see the decreasing of density of matter. It means that this magma should be propagates outside. And for example, propagate to the rim of the hot spot and form there some helps of density. And we can create it so we see that our sample as it is possible. Here it is as it is was previously. There is a microstrip resonator, to which we will apply the external microwave field. Here it's in such direction. It's magnetized by the across of its lens. Here it means that here around this resonator and above the resonator was the Einstein condensate. Is formed as an attack. And after that, we will scan around the heating spot by the probing laser along the microstrip resonator. You see, we will scan across bias magnetic field. So if a supercurrent is formed, the maximum intensity of supercurrent should be along the microstrip. So already in Bose-Einstein condensate. Moreover, when we scan here, always the reflection condition, this microstrip is a mirror from which light is reflected back. This means that we always have here the good reflectivity and condition of experiment and not change. And condensate is rather uniform. I told this scan. Previously, we can use one laser to heat and the same laser to probe. And here we use blue laser to heat. And this blue laser moves together with the cell. So this heating spot doesn't move, only probing spot moves. And let's look what will be in the center of the hot spot. In the center of the hot spot, you observe, as it was demonstrated, very fast decay of condensate. If you will stay on the rim, you see the formation of maximum after that decay, and after that, much more slower decay to the thermal mass. If you stay apart 200 micrometers from the central spot, somewhere here, you see. In this spot, it will will be the first peak will be formed when Bose Einstein condensate will be formed here. And the second peak appears when magnets, which are pushed out from the hot spot, reach this probing position. And if we will shift out the probing position, we see that the second peak also will shift. So they formed some way in Bose Einstein condensate, which pathway propagates outside. Moreover, if you will analyze and look in the opposite direction, it's possible to see even reflected paths which propagates to the end of the sample reflects back, and the first peak is formed here, green one, and the second one is here. Okay, what occurs when we have no heating, such distribution of density, and after that attenuation along the microstrip, pumping microstrip? When we have the hot spot, the first in the hot spot itself forms the huge dip, decreasing intensity of magnets, and outside, it's kind of diagram you see, propagates two hamps of magnet lines. Here you can see a video how it occurs for different heating powers. For example, this hemp which propagates out from the center. Here no heating, and here pulse is formed and propagates out. And we tried to understand what it is, just a second. And Victor Lowe proposed to describe this in frame of second sound scenario. So we describe our condensate by Gross-Peter-Yavsky equation and above the stationary distribution, take into account the repulsive interaction which was calculated in this article, take into account the ability of formation of Bogoliubov waves in Bose-Einstein condensate, which are one of the solutions of Gross-Peter-Yavsky equation. And it's this Bogoliubov wave can be treated as a second sound wave here. Okay, it depends on its dispersion. And its dispersion depends on the ratio between these two components in this term under the square root. And if it's clear, if this part is much more smaller than this one, we have linear dispersion law, and we can speak about second sound velocity, which is here dispersion coefficient, density of condensate, and here amplitude of four-way repulsive interaction. And after that, we analyzed our system, we analyzed, determined the propagation speed. It was 400 meters per second. You remember previously we had determined 300 meters per second, very close to this system. We can calculate dispersion coefficient, it's completely not a problem. We can estimate nonlinear frequency shift here. And also from the our experiments, we can look on the width of propagating pulse, it's approximately 44 micrometers, and calculate the carrier wave number from this 700 radian per centimeter, and that is why we can calculate these two terms here and here and compare them, and you see that this term is in our experiment 18 megahertz, and this term 0.3 megahertz, and really we satisfy the condition of linear dispersion law. And in such case, here we can speak about second sound. Moreover, we have measured these distance square time diagrams for different heating wave powers here, and we have determined the second sound velocity must be independent on the excitation conditions and the heating laser power, for example, which determines the BEC pulse here. Pulse visas are different, but the sound velocity is practically the same. 100% change in the width of the pulse of propagating pulse gives us approximately 8% change in the sound velocity. During the pulse propagation, the amplitude of the background condensate decays, and the sound velocity also has to decay. The sound velocity decrease is clearly visible from parabolic fields. You see here, sound velocity decrease. So, both statements satisfy. It's only the problem. The sound velocity decrease is much less than expected from the observed decay rate of the condensate. This may be explained by peculiarities of the propagation of intensive PEC hump, which gathers the condensed magnets in front and leaves the deep hole behind. So we have also estimated this and determined that hams decay, propagating hams decay approximately 5 times slower than decay of antihistoric possession. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Any questions? Go ahead.
So because you have here one of these things, say the global effects in the case of the dichotomies, right?
It's not our, we have not observed these effects. Yes. Evidence,
sure. Just a second. So the question is that there you have a DEC here. Oh, okay, with line vortices.
So, but very important magnetic materials like ferromagnets, the topological defense are basically disastrous. Is there any analogous system with a super property that actually can have?
So in many systems, the topological defects are surfaces, and so are there any
super
magnon analogs to surfaces, surface defects?
It's principally maybe, but as experimentalist, I can't say yes or not because we have not investigated. And it is maybe due to the simple reasons, because due to this decay time and necessity for the long lifetime of our condensates for more or less suitable analysis of its parameters. And here we have tried these Horsler compounds, for example, in such, but up to now it can be observed in such perfect way only in equilibrium. But it's, we suppose it's nice with the obstacles for other materials. If you can compensate that in such a way, for some parametric pumping or something, or spin torque transfer, you need to put it for some reasons. But concerning these super magnet states or something such, I can't answer the model.
All right, any other questions?
A simple question. At the beginning, you mentioned that the condensation happens because of three-wave or four-wave interactions. But then I didn't see in any of the theoretical approaches three-wave terms. I saw only four-wave terms. So
it is especially we especially chosen such experimental conditions when the stream magnet splitting process suppressed.
Okay.
Due to the momentum and the energy conservation. Yeah, okay. It is especially done in order to treat this system as closer to ideal.
Can that such can be included or not?
Principally, yes. There is many.
How to do it?
How we can, experimentally, it's necessary only to decrease magnetic.
No, correct.
Theoretically, it's maybe it's a question to Victor Wolf.
No, it can be done without any problem. It's definitely doable.
Yes, for me, it is not a problem. It's only one. Okay. It's important process, important fact why it is not necessary principally triple. Because in such a case, the threshold of these. Splitting process will be significantly lower than four magnet state. That is why if you take into account three magnet process, we can forget about four magnet process. And three magnet process in many cases, don't lead to the establishing of quasi-equilibrium, but to the formation of some hot spot in different place of spectrum, which is the direct transfer of energy of the cycle. That is why it's far away from three. But it's my experiment.
Okay, one last question.
What is the size of the magnon-magnon interaction?
In which terms?
Ideal?
What is the frequency shift for such?
Yes. So my question.
What interaction parameter do you put at the Grossmann density? There's a G, right?
It is, yes, but okay, it's a frequency, non-linear frequency shift there. Which is, by the way, it's a very interesting question here. This is amplitude of four-wave repulsive interaction. Yeah? this one. It's such, you have seen, I have demonstrated how it is the frequency decreases due to the increase in temperature of such. It's very similar to the physical reason for this, with self-interaction in the system. When we increase the density of magnets, we decrease the longitudinal magnetization. It's such a frequency goes down. This should be negative, this increase of density of magnets. But in this article, and rather small, as I have demonstrated, it's something a few kilohertz something. And here, when I have at the bottom of spectrum, it depends on the position in the spectrum. And that is why it's not so simple task, because these four-wave interaction coefficient change sign and change value depending on the position in phase. And but here in this article, it was taken into account the interaction between plus and minus k components of Bose-Einstein condensate. And this leads to the change in sign and in value. Value increased approximately 100 times, and here also sign is not negative but positive. But it still should be checked, and one of our PhD students works with supervising of Victor Lowe on calculation of nonlinear interaction coefficients inside of magnets.
Okay, that's today all question. Later, if you have a question, you may interact with us. Let's thank Zipkio again.